and welcome to another Let's Talk. Today, I'm with Booty by Elle, also known as Ellen Willard, who's going to talk to us today all about herself. Hi there, how are you doing?
Good, thanks. How are you?
Yeah, good. I'm not too bad. So, do you want to start off telling us a little bit about yourself, who you are, what you do, and where you're from?
Ellen, I'm 22. I'm from Hastings, which is kind of like southeast area of England in the UK. I'm an online fitness coach and one-to-one PT, so I actually do have in-person clients as well. I've only been in this position for around 3-ish months now, and I do social media kind of on the side with that as well.
So how did you start your fitness journey? Did you do like PT in a gym and then you turned to online, or did you always go online?
I'm lucky enough to have my own gym in my garden, which my parents built like a fair few years back. And then just before lockdown, we converted it into like kind of like my ideal gym. And I started doing one-to-one PTs in there. I was doing like online PTs as well. And I'd done a couple in person before starting out like kind of my online coaching. But I've kind of like grown the same, like both of them at the same time. So I've kind of like, I would definitely recommend to anyone looking to get into PTing and like online coaching is to do it in the gym first. Like you need that gym floor experience to then be able to develop into like a really good online coach. Mm-hmm. But I think with me, I kind of done both at the same time. I definitely had like a heavier focus on online at one point. I'd say it's like pretty equal in the sense of doing like in person and online.
Yeah. So then with everything COVID related, it hasn't really affected you then because you've always sort of been online.
I was actually a retail manager up until June.
All right.
Yeah, I was a part-time retail manager and I was doing all of my sort of like online coaching and PTing on the side of that. Mm-hmm. And I'd never taken the plunge and thought to myself, I can do this full time, until sort of the first lockdown we had in the UK. Everything picked up. Everyone was kind of after home workout programs. Business got like crazy. And I just got myself into like a really fortunate position that I could then go into doing that full time.
Yeah.
So lockdown kind of worked in my favor on that part. But I've definitely found that the further we progress, obviously the more people are struggling financially. So business, although it kind of was like very linear at first, it's kind of like found, it's gone down a lot. And now we're kind of just like
twiddling along
with it. Yeah.
Do you think that's because of people's then attitude to especially the second lockdown we're having in the UK?
From my perspective, a lot of people are very much not following guidelines and are pretty much doing what they can, but obviously they don't have access to a gym anymore. So I do think, although people do have this kind of like blasé view towards lockdown and its restrictions, mm-hmm. they physically then don't have the means to be able to do their training. So I do think a lot of people think to themselves, you know what, I can't be arsed, I'm not going to do it.
So what would you say then is the sort of importance of having gyms open? Because of course, like the argument that I've discussed with a few people is when they look at it and don't deem it essential because you can go on a run outside, but then there's a massive difference between going on a run and doing that form of exercise compared to in the gym doing other exercises.
I'm very much like a firm believer in that the gym, although it has its physical benefits, it has its mental benefits a lot. And I know for me, if I didn't have my gym outside, I would be struggling so much because yes, like you can, there's a lot that you can do with your own body weight. But I think in terms of the endorphins and how resistance training makes you feel both mentally and physically, like you just can't get that same sort of rush and enjoyment. Well, I know some people can't anyway. And I've even had it with my dad where he says to me, why don't you try go running? And I'm just like, yeah, but for me running, it's, and for a lot of people, it's quite heavy impact in the sense that not all of our bodies can adapt to that. Where I have a lot of muscle mass, I'm not an ideal body shape to be able to do long distance running. I 100% could because I used to do cross country. I've sort of like evolved myself to be more of like a weightlifter and like a crossfitter. And although like that does then involve cardio, running isn't like my predominant sport.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's really hard to say to people, well, you can still, like, you can go outside, you can run, you can get your like daily exercise in, but the people who are then sort of like deciding these restrictions aren't the people that benefit from the like psychological and physiological effects that exercise and specifically resistance training has on you.
It was quite interesting that actually my PT and me, we're still able to do one-to-ones sort of outside at a social distance. And we were speaking about, because he's training me for the boxing fight, he was saying like, running's good, but training-wise for the boxing, it's useless because there's a completely different muscle activated from running compared to all the other cardio-based training we do that's more beneficial towards the boxing. So then, like you say, like most people, as much as you do the CrossFitting and all that, it's completely different to running.
With running as well, I think where it like it is heavy impact in the sense of like, especially if you do tend to like store a lot more like muscle mass, the amount of weight you like, the amount of impact you then have when you are running, like it is increased. But when it comes to sort of like CrossFit training, you're mixing kind of cardio with resistance training, and in my opinion that's more of sort of like a functional view of things. Like it's going to be more beneficial for your body in the long run because you're not only increasing sort of your body's flexibility and mobility and like resistance to load used, but you're also increasing your cardiovascular endurance. So I think a combination of the two is more optimal as opposed to doing just running. Obviously from running, there's like little, in my opinion, there's little sort of like give back that you receive.
Yeah. It's mainly just sort of as a mental thing to sort of clear the mind almost. That's how I see running anyway.
I actually do agree with that. I think that's what particularly my dad finds with running as well, is that he kind of uses it as his outlet from like work and stuff. And I guess that's kind of similar then to those that who do choose to go to the gym.
So then with your fitness and stuff, if running and the CrossFit is the two different things, but as sort of is discussed in normal fitness, all of that isn't the most important. It's more so dietitian and nutrition. That's almost the most healthiest with fitness and stuff. What is your opinions then on nutrition? Because of course I know you were on a vegan based diet, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm on a vegan based diet, much to a lot of people's disgust. I think my view on nutrition is that I very much follow, like, I don't want to say, it's kind of like the 80-20 approach. Like, I'm sure you've probably heard of that. It's common in like a lot of like fitness influencers. Mm-hmm. But my main view is that it should mirror how you want your health to be, because I do believe that what we put into our bodies is very much reflective of our health. And obviously if we don't then feed our bodies with the right nutrition, we are going to find that we are suffering from like the side effects of that. With that being said, I'm also in the mindset of you should live life with no restriction, but with that does come balance. So I'm very much an avid believer of balance within nutrition. So you should get yourself to a point, like a lot of people approach the gym and they approach nutrition with a very restrictive mindset, and they think that they need to be like really restrictive in order to see like XYZ in results. Whereas for the most part, 9 times out of 10, most people aren't athletes. They don't have like it's not their life, like it's not their livelihoods. They're not doing it at that same like level of intensity. Like most people go to the gym or go for a run to keep fit and to stay fit. So we don't have to like keep up with the same sort of strict diet as what said athletes would. Mm-hmm. And for those who are just looking to keep fit and stay fit, you can pretty much follow like a really well-balanced diet and still enjoy the foods that you love. And I, with the whole vegan side of things, mine's definitely more ethical related as opposed to health related. I do think there are a lot of myths in terms of like being a vegan, especially in terms of like saying like lean meat's really bad for you and stuff. Like I'm not one of those people that is on that side of things. I'm not gonna be like, oh, lean meat's really bad for you. Obviously red meat has somewhat side effects if consumed in like mass consumptions, But with the whole vegan side of things, it's definitely more ethical. But I do think a lot of us could benefit from going a bit more plant-based.
I've always admired you completely, because I used to be a massive fussy eater like last year, and it's only recently I've started proper like taking note of what I'm eating and stuff. So it's funny because I used to eat so much crap, and I used to be a bit bigger. And then literally, I didn't change anything about my diet other than I stopped snacking on crisps, chocolate bars, and biscuits throughout the day. And then immediately, like, a load of weight just dropped, but nothing else in my diet changed. And I feel like a lot of people don't understand that. When they think diet, they think very small amounts of chicken, rice, and, you know, maybe a bit of fish. When realistically, like, I eat so much rubbish, as in, like, plates of mash and sausages and bacon and mushrooms and peppers and fried stuff, but it's all done in a nice proportion to then benefit them what I need again from nutrition wise, calorie wise, and then what food goes well with boxing.
Oh, I 100% agree with you. I think although my sort of approach is like 80-20, it's because I genuinely enjoy fueling my body with sort of like voluminous, fibrous foods. So obviously that is like your green leafy veg and your like beans and your lentils. Like, I enjoy eating that food because I get more from it. So in like, I have tracked calories before in the past, and I found that when I do, I want to make the most out of what I am having. So when it does come to having meals, I personally would opt for homemade curry from like lentils and chickpeas, which is very voluminous. I know it's going to fill me up, but it's also then does have the nutritious, like, nutritional value as well. My view is that I hate like the whole categorization of like good and bad food. I hate like the mindset towards viewing food as like really good and really bad. Like, in my opinion, I have seen like a quote very similar somewhere, but it was like, some food is good for the body and some food is good for the soul. So there's this whole idea that in terms of nutritional value, not all foods come on par. They still have their benefits in terms of how we feel when we eat them. And if we can find an enjoyment in that, then mentally it's good for us. So I do like agree with you in the sense that specifically sometimes the content of what we're eating is the sole sort of contributor to the results that we gain from the gym. It's more so just dependent on what your goals are. You can be in a calorie deficit, a calorie surplus, or maintenance, and if you're hitting all of your macros, the contents of what you're eating isn't going to have much of an effect on that.
An interesting course. Can you remember where you read that from?
What, the quote?
Yeah.
I can't remember. I literally just think I was on like a vegan Instagram post that I saw, like one of the vegan Instagram accounts that I follow.
Because I've always laughed because it goes on that quote almost, because you can, there's loads of food that I eat, which in look at any online diet, the bad for you. But it's all the right foods. It's just, you know, I've fried some of these onions or I've put some seasoning on the chicken and that. And realistically, that doesn't take away from how healthy it is. It's still a really healthy meal. I've added a bit of flavoring, but that's because it's the fat I'm having is then the good fat, because your body naturally needs natural fats. So
100%.
People just forget and just think of cutting all the fat out of the system completely, which is massively wrong anyway.
I know.
So how long have you then been on this like vegan diet?
I've learned to go into it. So I've only actually been a vegan for about a year and I think 8 months-ish.
Okay.
So not actually long at all. And I went completely cold turkey with it. I mean, my family as well, like, we weren't massive red meat eaters. Like, my mum's one of those people that is like, no, we'll get like turkey mince, or we'll get like sort of like the poultry alternatives. Like, we've never been like a massive red meat family, not for any specific reason, just because that's just how it's been. With my sort of raising interest and like my increasing interest within the environment and like sustainability within like fashion and fitness, it then, the ethical side of things like really played on my mind. I was just like, how can I preach that I like love the environment and I am all for like sustainability when the number, like the first contribution that I can make as a consumer is to go more plant-based. Mm-hmm. And I just felt as an individual, I wasn't contributing in any sort of way. And for me, that was like the one thing that I could do to contribute in some type of way. And although one person doesn't make a massive difference, any type of contribution, in my opinion, was helpful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think where I did go cold turkey with it, you don't realize how many foods contain like vitamins derived from animals. And I was having cereal and it had vitamin B12 in it, and turns out it was B12 derived from like a cow. And it's just like, there is an option for all sort of companies to do things in like a more environmentally friendly way. It's just they opt for like the cheaper option as opposed to the option that's more ethical.
Yeah.
So especially like with the cereals, there's so many other brands that contain B12, but they're synthetic B12. It's not derived from animals. So it's just like, how can one company be on like so far in advance of what the world needs, and like this other company still be going by sort of like the easy route?
Mm-hmm.
So the ethical side of things is just like, I think that's just been the main part. I've not really been like an avid believer of like all of the health benefits it supposedly brings you as well.
Then sort of with them benefits and that mindset, when you do the online coaching or when you do your sort of guides for clients and stuff, do you sort of shift them over to this sort of diet base, or do you sort of let them still freely pick their own nutrition?
Not as much as I would love to preach sort of my beliefs onto people, I would never push it. So like any client that comes to me, we talk about sort of their dietary requirements, and most people are just like general. They'll just eat sort of whatever, and then they just have a short list of what their dislikes are. And I would never then create sort of an example meal plan and be like completely plant-based in it, because they'd be like, well, that's not what I've told you.
Mm-hmm.
I've had a lot of people, I think a lot of people who look to go vegan and then see that I am, then come to me and say, oh, I've seen that you're vegan as well, and I'd like a bit of help with that. So I love that part of it, but then knowing that for most people, they wouldn't be able to go cold turkey with going vegan, because there's so much out there that's not.
Yeah.
It's like a slow introduction to that. But no, I never push it onto people. I'm kind of like in the sense that people can choose their dietary choices freely. And as much as I would like for them to like try more of a plant-based diet, it's not my place to push that onto them.
Well, that's good. So then what do you do with sort of online coaching? What sort of structure do you have when it comes to the clients and stuff?
Bit of a sticky one at the moment, because I basically started my online coaching business back in January, and I went with a company that from the like outside perspective, I thought were like incredible. All of like a lot of big names that I'd follow on social media were with said company. And whilst like I'm still within somewhat contract with them, I've decided it's not the route that I'm looking to go down with my online coaching. I'm very much someone who's for the one-to-one side of things. So I really want like a really personal client to coach relationship. I want to learn like everything I can about their lives. And I'm more so looking to coach the few as opposed to looking to coach the many. Whereas the website that I was with look to coach the many, and it was more so about like pushing sales and getting as many people as you can for like a really budgeted price, and that's great. Like I'm very much what I want to help as many people as I can, so I still do offer somewhat of like a budget programming, but it's very generic, in the sense that you kind of choose which program you want to go on, and then every 4 weeks you'll get sort of like a new program given to you, but it's not personalized to what your individual needs are. So I'm still with that company because I have built up like a very big clientele base with them. I'm trying to get people sort of switched, like transitioned over to the new platform that I'm working on at the moment. But I have then had to have a difficult conversation with myself and saying, okay, value your time, value your expertise. You need to start charging more for your one-to-one coaching, because where it was so budgeted on the other one, there were no limitations to how many clients that I could take on. And it was kind of, I never got to have a one-to-one consult call with them and actually get to know them. It was all done kind of like via email, because it wasn't feasible to coach like 200 people, because at one given time I had like 200 people on my platform.
Yeah.
And it's that, to me, that's not coaching. It's just programs. Like, I'm not your coach. I'm just providing you with a program, because there's no chance that any individual can take on 200 clients and still like give them their undivided attention. Like, I should be given like at least 1 hour a week minimum to like every paying client.
Mm-hmm.
So I've had to have this tough conversation, kind of switch to a new platform, feel as though I'm kind of like stepping in the wrong direction now, but I know that in the long run it's going to pay off a lot more. And so now the way in which we kind of onboard clients is they can either fill out an inquiry form, or they can just like submit a form on the website, and then from there they can book in a free 15-minute consult call with me. I had one, well, I've had two today, literally like right before this.
Yeah.
And from there we just sort of just have like a general discussion. I get to know them a bit, get to know a bit about what their experience is within like fitness and the gym, what is it they want to gain. And I'm more so in the mindset of seeing if people are a good match for me and if I'm a good match for them. So I think I can gauge that from a 15-minute conversation with them. Like, you can gauge whether you're going to work well together or not within a 15-minute conversation. Particularly with, I'm sort of under the mindset of I'm guiding the conversation, I'm getting the questions I want, there's the opportunity for them to ask any questions. And it's kind of like a really quick process of understanding whether we're on the same page in terms of what we want. And I think with my old website, I never had that element of things. So I never had a choice over people of who I'd coach. Mm-hmm. And I know if, like, for a lot of people, they just view like a paying customer as a paying customer. It's like, woo, yeah, you want to sign up to me, you want to be my client, you're going to pay me, that's great. Whereas for me, I'm all for, if I had a consult call with someone and they said XYZ to me, and I thought, do you know what, this is out of my sort of area of expertise, I don't think I'd be the best for you. I'd be the type of person to maybe say that and then suggest someone else, or point them in the right direction towards someone else. Like, a client to me is not just a paying customer.
I feel like it's definitely more needed, because it just helps having that sort of that comfort with a trainer or from your point of view with a client. Be able to build that rapport.
I think as well, I crave that kind of one-to-one relationship with a client. Like, it's what I love. I love one-to-one PTs in my private gym outside. Like, I love sort of like the facial expressions in people's face where they push themselves beyond what they thought their limiting beliefs were. Mm-hmm. And that's something I just thrive off, and I think I get that same sort of feeling and like rewarding feeling, because it is a type of like self reward from doing the one-to-one coaching as well.
I always have a laugh with my personal trainer, because I'll always I used to always go into the gym, now I'm going to the field. We'll have a quick chat, just how each other's days went. But I always can tell by his face, if he's smiling erratically, I know fine well it's going to be a horrible session. And I wear at him, complain at him, and just yell at him. And then at the end of it, I'll say, thank you, that was the best session I've ever had. And just to see his face as well, to be that impressed with us is from doing the exercises he's put us through, it's nice for him to sort of see that then personal growth that his clients have had, that I've had. And then for me, it's nice to see that like someone is generally interested in me bettering myself.
100%. I think that element of a coach, like, you're not going to be a successful coach if you don't actually care. As much, like, as far as sort of it can take you, like, it can take you so far, in the sense that yes, you may gain clients, but eventually, if your clients don't put their trust in you and they don't actually genuinely believe that you have some sort of like care and respect from them, as you said, like the rapport is just, it's not going to be there. You're not going to build that like relationship. And especially if you're more of like a top end coach, if you're invest, because it's an investment at the end of the day, especially if you get someone who's like a bit more on the pricier side, you're invested into them. And I think if that reciprocation isn't there from my side, then I've done a sort of like dishonor to myself, because I've not reached sort of like my end of the agreement that we first set out when we signed, like, and when we joined together.
No, I agree with that, because you know, I've had one or two bad PT experiences where I haven't felt that that bond, and you do just feel, as a client, you do feel awful and think like, I'm not getting anything. Like, you're putting us through the workouts, you're putting us through the sets and that, but I'm not feeling like I'm getting anything from this. But then with the one I'm currently with, where me and him do have a good laugh and that, we'll get the job done, and at the end of the day I feel like I've done the best I've ever done that week.
I think it's because it's mentally rewarding as well though, like, as it's so important, like a client coach relationship is, it goes so much more beyond just a program and your personalized macros. And I think if your client isn't connecting with you on a mental basis, like if you're not on the same page mentally in the sense of like your core values as well, then it's just not going to work. So you need to get that sort of mental gain from it, as well as like connection with them, for sure. And it's definitely something that I crave, so I'm sure that a lot of people who are looking for a coach like experience this as well. So many personal trainers and coaches out there, particularly from what I see on social media, my whole social media is just coach after coach after coach, because obviously I'm only following people within the fitness industry, so it just for me it seems so oversaturated.
Well, it's interesting you should say that, because it reminds me of a post, I think it was today or it might have been the other day, you posted, especially sort of on fitness influencers and sort of the misleadingness of it all.
I think it was that one today. Was it about using, like, I said marketing tools, but it's more so marketing gimmicks to sort of mislead their audience? A tricky one within the fitness industry. I think as much as I don't like to fight fire with fire, and I don't want to experience gain at the detriment of somebody else. So like I don't want to get into anything like cancel culture, or I don't want to have to out people, or seem as though I'm just like really negative. But at the same time, it's equally frustrating when you are someone who devotes your livelihood to educating people in the right way, that you do have people out there who lean more towards like the niches and like the trends. So the whole sort of like burn back fat, or like tone your inner thighs, and as I put earlier, like get rid of your bra bulge, like all of these sort of misleading workout titles, which to any normal person are very enticing, because you're like, oh my. So for example, there was somebody I saw that did one of these posts the other day, and the comments, like the person got a huge following, and the comments were like, oh yeah, like I need to do that. And it just, it makes your viewers and it makes your impressionable followers look at insecurities that they didn't think were insecurities. Because especially if you've kind of like, the bra bulge thing is a very like, it's a tiny little thing, and it's inevitable in most people. If you wear a sports bra that's too tight, you're probably going to get a bit of a bulge there. A lot of people might not even think anything of it, and then they see somebody post a workout saying get rid of this, and they're like, oh, but I didn't even think it was a problem. And then it just sends them on a downward spiral with that. So whilst at the same time I know that these people maybe do mean good, in the sense that they're teaching people to stay active, to get off their feet, like to do some sort of like training in, as such, and exercise. But at the same time, like, I do just think it's not informative, and it's not teaching your followers in the right way.
Yeah, because there's loads of ones I've seen sort of online who do sort of similar things.
And yeah,
you look at the workouts or the exercises, it's either completely bad technique or form, or it's just a ridiculous move which is completely unnecessary. And you just think, like, they really are reaching for like the uneducated and the gullible people, and they pinpoint these like insecurities and then turn it into profit for them. So it's annoying to see that on my feed.
Followers as well, like, where social media, like the age in which people join up is getting a lot younger, they are so much more impressionable, particularly within teenage girls. Like, I hate to just target girls, because like it is very prevalent in boys as well, but particularly with teenage girls, like I see it in my little sister sometimes, like they're obsessed with social media and like being the same, and then they kind of get this like idea in their head that they need to look a certain way, and then like these workouts just don't help at all with that. But yeah, like some like fitness influencers will do the absolute most to make sure that they stand out.
Well,
carry on.
It's quite nice, because just before I came on this call here, I was going through my Instagram myself, and Matt Does Fitness had posted a picture, and I think he's released a video on it as well. And you know, yeah. I can go from sort of a male point of view on the whole looking at social media, while you, of course, being a female and having a little sister, can go on the female side.
Yeah.
But of course, like, just as a person anyway, judging himself to others, Matt Does Fitness is a very large, very muscular individual. And he posted a picture of himself just looking completely normal, and it looked like he had a bit of a more pudged out belly, but I mean, you could still see his abs and stuff. And then there was one right next to it where he's literally just popping every vein, yeah, muscle. And he said, the only difference between this is I went on a quick like run and I sprayed myself with some water and I turned a few legs. Yeah. And that's really...
I saw his video.
Oh, I haven't had time to watch it yet.
Yeah, I saw the video behind it.
But no, I want to watch that.
Yeah, it's really good. But what was your opinion on that then?
I felt it was well needed. Like, I'm not an insecure person about my body, and I know, sort of doing photography and videography, I know all the tricks that big influencers use to sort of make elements of themselves bigger or smaller or more defined and stuff. Like, I know the tricks of how to do it. So to me, like, it's when I see it and when I look at myself, I know fine, well, like, I'm happy and I'm comfortable. There's a lot for myself personally to still develop, but that's just my own personal goals. But to see someone as Matt Does Fitness, who is heavily respected in the fitness industry, and you know, if you see any sort of like teen post Twitter feeds or whatever where it's like, oh, these attractive guys, it's always mainly a picture of him somewhere on it. So it's great to see him with such a large following and how many eyes he's got on him to be talking about this topic is quite inspiring, and I think is well needed.
100% agree with you. I did a reel the other day, and I basically just was turning around, posing, doing like different moves that I do in all of like my everyday like pretty pictures as such on Instagram. And I just put the caption as, you see one split second of what was 100 photos for me.
Yeah.
Like, you see just one photo out of what sometimes can... I've actually had it before where I've had 450 photos taken in one go. Just because I'll get my little sister or something to like take a photo of me, and she'll just hold it down and it takes it however many, like it does a burst or whatever. You've literally seen one of those. Like, you haven't seen me scroll through every 400 of those and been like, oh, what one's actually half decent to me. And I think it is really nice to then see people sort of show the photos that to them probably aren't as good, and they aren't sort of like the really perfect photos. And there is a lot, like particularly within people who have large followings, there's a lot that goes into actually doing an Instagram post. mm-hmm. like you said, like lighting and yeah, in the video, Matt does actually spray himself with water. I was just like, oh wow, you're really doing the most. But it, again, like Instagram, it is just like, as a lot of people say, your highlight reel, and you do want to show like the good sides of yourself.
Yeah, well, it's the thing that people don't understand. The thing sort of filtering is, you know, you go on Instagram and you flick through and you get them filters, but you've got real life filters. So you've got positioning, you've got stance, you've got, you know, the whole use do it. You put your one left leg or something behind further than the other and it makes it look much bigger.
Yeah.
So, you know, you've got the water, you've got lighting and stuff. If the shadow hits perfectly, everything sort of pops. Like, so people need to be sort of more aware of than real life filters as well.
100%. And I think it's just when you scroll through Instagram, you don't, or like any social media, you don't take that into account. Like you don't, as I say, like we kind of need to emotionally detach ourselves from social media and have that kind of like breakup, like that breakup relationship with social media, and just take it for what it is. It is a highlight reel. Like we need to learn to understand that, and not become too sort of obsessed with continuously comparing ourselves to people. And I think the longer we spend on our phones and we spend on scrolling, the less we view ourselves as being adequate.
Yeah, no, I agree. Especially the need to understand that it's not the real world we're living right now is real. As soon as we go on Instagram and that, it's no longer real. It's all idolized, it's perfected, it's artificial.
100%.
Speaking quickly then of imperfections and insecurities and stuff, you also posted a few stories on your skin and some skin products you've been using.
Oh, like I've never struggled with bad skin whatsoever. I don't know what happened, but come lockdown, like my skin was just like a mental physical deterioration. I think it must have just been related to a hormone imbalance of some sort. I'm not entirely sure. Yeah, like it got me bad. I was very grateful to say that we were in lockdown. Obviously, when it actually got to its worst point, I had to go back to my retail job. I stayed there for a month until I actually handed in my notice. I had to go back to my retail job and we were wearing visors as well. And obviously, like with your skin, like the bacteria, it thrives off of bacteria, like, and heat, and like where you're wearing the visor, there's so much heat that the bacteria is just thriving in the environment, and it was making my skin so much worse. And I know that's such a first world problem to have, but it affected me so much mentally. And I, even with my partner, I'd be like, I don't even want to take off my makeup, because it's just like, it's there. And I think where you're having to look at yourself every day, like it's literally your face as well. And I think where it is so personal and it's like kind of the viewpoint to like most people, like it's the first thing that they look at when they look at you, like having that there, it was just like so mentally deteriorating. Mm-hmm. And like without, I'm one of those people that's like kind of like, oh, sorry, like if I get a spot, I'm like, oh, it's a spot, like I don't really care. And I've never experienced acne of any sort, when that kind of came on, I was like, whoa, like this is intense. I've literally taken my skin for granted my whole life. And it's not because it's unattractive, like we've kind of been taught to think that it's unattractive or conditioned to believe that it is. I guess have like being brought up to believe that acne was unattractive, you then just have that instilled in you that when it is on your face, you're like, oh, I'm so ugly.
Has it been getting better for you?
Like I literally don't have a spot on my face right now, which is weird. Like that's why it was so odd to me. Yeah, I think obviously where I was so uncomfortable, it was just something that I'd never experienced firsthand. And like I do kind of have that in the back of my mind now where I'm like, oh, what if like it does come back? And it's so strange because I'm not really someone who now is really insecure. Maybe like 4 or 5 years ago, I was so, so insecure. But just having that sort of element of insecurity coming back to me again was like a really foreign feeling. And I absolutely, like, I was not a fan of it.
Speaking sort of just on a product basis, what then brands have you managed to partner with or work with or?
So I actually work with My Protein. Mm-hmm. So I'm an ambassador for My Protein. I've been with them since April last year, I think it was about a year and six, seven-ish months. But I don't really tend to work with a lot of brands. I have had a lot of brands reach out to me, and I'm just one of those people that I like to do my content for me. I like my content how it is. I don't want to have to force content out just because it's like a brand. But my protein, like, I use them before I then started working with them. I do work with Pure Sport CBD, which is just as it sounds, it's a CBD company, but not on like a contract basis. So if people decide to like shop through my link, then I'll earn like a slight commission from that. And then they'll send me like a free bottle of CBD every now and again, but I'm not obliged to post about it. It's just something like that I can push as and when I please to. What else? I'm under actually like a management now, which is always something that I've wanted. So I'm with a management company called W Model, and they basically sort all of your kind of like brand deals out for you. But we're starting to realize, I've always found that no brands, like brands that I want to work with me. And it's something that I've always like kind of just had to come to terms with. It's something that I can't work out why.
What brands would you like to work with?
Would I like to work with? I'd love to work with like Gymshark or like Alphalete, like a clothing brand. Obviously, you've literally got Gymshark on right now.
I was going to say, as I support them, right?
But I think those two brands, or like Tala, I don't know if you've heard of Tala. It's kind of like a...
I think my partner, she knows them, yeah.
It's kind of like an up-and-coming brand. Yeah, one of those three, purely because like I've religiously bought from them. They've been the best clothing, like the best fitness clothing that I've ever had. Gymshark in particular, I like what they stand for, in the sense that like fitness is for everyone, it's not just for the select few. But can't see that happening anytime soon, which I'm happy with. Like,
oh, it's I'm good. Happy with. It's good you're plodding along doing your own thing, but you know, you never know, opportunities come about. Do you have anything you'd sort of like to finally say?
I think if I was to say anything to anyone watching, so in regards to social media, emotionally break up with your phone. So don't take what you see too seriously. I know that's really easier said than done, but social media is full of so much information, and we are the only ones that are in control of how we take it. So we're the only ones that evidently are in control of how we view it and how we then process it in our minds. So if you do go through that emotional breakup with your phone and with social media, you kind of take away from the fact that, like, you take away that element of like seeing real life in it, because it's not real life. Like, nothing you see on there is as it seems. You don't know what's going on behind the scenes. And to not then fall into this trap of comparing yourself to everything that you see on there, because not everyone is like wholeheartedly as happy as what they seem, or as settled as what they seem, or as successful as what they seem. Like, you don't see the whole story or the whole picture behind it.
Yeah, I think that's a perfect way definitely to end. So do you have any contact details or where people can find you and see your stuff?
So obviously I've got my Instagram, which is bootybuy_L. And then I have my coaching platform, which is www.builtbymecoaching.com, which is where you can inquire about programming or one-to-one coaching. And then on YouTube, I am just bootybuyl.
Brilliant. Right. So thank you everyone for watching and listening to the podcast. Thank you very much, Elle, for coming onto the show. Really do appreciate it. It's been lovely having you.
No, thank you. Thank you so much for having me. I really enjoyed it.
You're very welcome. So please go check out all of her links. That'll be in the descriptions. And I'll see you in another episode.
I hope you enjoyed the video. Don't forget to let me know what you want to see next. Don't forget to click that subscribe button. Thank you so much for watching, and I will catch you in the next one.